Good evening, and thank you for joining us at tonight's PRISM event. In my time here as faculty in the School of Public Health, I focused primarily on the study of intimate partner violence, which, for those of you unfamiliar with the term, refers to a pattern of abuse or violence directed at a current or former intimate partner, for example, spouses, ex-spouses, dating partners, ex-dating partners. I've studied a number of varied topics related to intimate partner violence over the years, but one of the ones that I continue to be most passionate about is identifying policy-relevant solutions for child witnesses to parental intimate partner violence. So as health researchers, we tend to start our thought process with concepts of study design. Who are we studying? What exposures or interventions are we interested in knowing the effect of, and on which health or health-related outcomes? So tonight, we're interested in these people here. Ideally, free from trauma exposure or other profound hardship, this is what childhood looks like and should be about, yes? Joy, innocence, wonder, growth, exploration, all experienced in safe and nurturing environments that allow for healthy development. Child witnesses to parental intimate partner violence, on the other hand, grow up under circumstances defined by fear, and in the worst of these circumstances, even terror. An environment in which one parent is threatening and harming the other, even in the absence of physical harm to the child, serves as a direct threat to that child's sense of safety and self-worth. However, many parents and professionals over the years have mistakenly believed that children exposed to parental intimate partner violence because they're not the direct victims of that abuse themselves do not suffer adverse consequences. Additionally, parents tend to underestimate the exposure children have to this abuse, assuming that the children were protected from seeing or hearing these events, often thinking that they slept through them. However, studies with child witnesses have shown this to be inaccurate. Children who were believed by their parents to be unaware of the abuse report otherwise and often can describe detailed characteristics of the abusive events. Case in point, here are just two examples of the many poignant and dramatic drawings made by child witnesses. The drawing on the left, although not as gruesome as one on the right, speaks volumes to the often unspoken message behind the exposure to parental intimate partner violence, even for children who are not also victims of child abuse. You're next. In addition to having to fear tragic harm to and possible loss of their victimized parent, they also live with the continued looming fear of suffering the same harms. As we heard with Pamela's work and also Dr. Brown's work, children exposed to parental intimate partner violence are at a risk of a number of adverse health outcomes across their lifetime. For example, they're at increased risk of depression, post-traumatic stress disorder, risk-taking behaviors, substance abuse issues, low educational attainment, and becoming the next generation of intimate partner violence victims and perpetrators. So what can we do to help? I'll start with a brief story about my first research grant experience. Shortly before I was to defend my dissertation, I was encouraged to write a research grant for a call for intimate partner violence research by the National Institute of Justice. Wasn't ideal timing. I was also looking for a house with my partner at the time, so my stress level was pretty high. But I did have what I thought was a pretty good idea. And so I proposed studying how child custody and visitation orders differed between divorcing parents with and without a history of intimate partner violence. I was fortunate, there were model statutes on this topic set out by the National Council of Juvenile and Family Court Judges, and there were a number of policy guidelines saying what should be done in these cases by the American Medical Association, the American Bar Association, and other professional agencies. But we really had no empirical research whatsoever on this topic. We didn't know what courts were doing, we didn't know how often they were identifying these cases, and how they were responding to these cases. So I was fortunate enough to be awarded that grant, and one of the most simplest findings was one of the most pertinent. half of the IPV cases had no mention of a history of IPV, or intimate partner violence, sorry, intimate partner violence in the dissolution case, even though they were involving children. So within about a year or so of these results being released, a statute changed. In Washington State, it's now required that parents or other guardians are required to undergo a court and criminal background check to assure that the court knows what's happening and what's in the best interest of these children. So I knew I had stumbled into an area where I had potential to make meaningful change. So perhaps not surprisingly, my work largely continues to focus on the intersection of public health and family law, an area with the potential to reach large numbers of victims and child witnesses and affect meaningful, practical change in their futures. To put this into context, even quite conservative estimates suggest that at least 150,000 child witnesses are involved in their parents' divorces in the U.S. each year. Child custody orders can offer a number of avenues for integrating legal protections. These orders can require, for example, that child visitation by the abusing parent be supervised or deny that visitation altogether. They can place restrictions on the amount or other conditions of child visitation, and they can also order treatment completion, for example, batterer's intervention, substance abuse treatment, and mental health treatment. And then there's many other protections that these orders can put into place. With this in mind, a few of my most recent studies have focused on the possible ways to intervene in family law systems to protect victims and their children in the context of child custody and visitation orders. My most recent research focuses on two key players with the potential to influence outcomes in these orders, namely attorneys and parenting evaluators. The role of an attorney, not surprisingly, is to serve the best interest of their client, generally the parent they represent, whereas parenting evaluators serve the best interest of the child. And parenting evaluators are ordered in more complex cases, and they're ordered to investigate the family as a whole. My team and I recently completed a study that examined whether IPV victims with attorney representation were awarded greater legal protections in child custody proceedings compared to strongly matched victims without attorney representation. They were, in fact, and the outcomes were most protective for those represented by legal aid attorneys, as opposed to private attorneys. We studied them both separately. Both were effective in garnering greater protections, but legal aid attorneys really knocked it out of the park. And I think this is likely due in part to their greater training and experience in intimate partner violence cases. We're currently following up on that set of cases to examine whether those legal protections translate into lower rates of child maltreatment and intimate partner violence in the 3 years following divorce. We're also conducting a study, as Dean Godwin mentioned, to examine whether parenting evaluators are following national guidelines in their investigations and whether cases with a parenting evaluator also result in greater legal protections being awarded in child custody orders. Given the variation in parenting evaluators' backgrounds and training, this is a particularly contentious area in need of empirical evidence to guide policy. We have and will continue to disseminate our results from these studies to stakeholders both within and outside of the legal system so that they might be used to inform and guide family law policy to improve the safety and well-being of IPV victims and their children. I'm genuinely hopeful that our work will continue to affect meaningful change to better the lives of child witnesses and their victim parents. Thank you very much.